Hi friends, this is Chris with Josephine's Design. I am back with day 8 of our Spring Summer Bible Journaling Camp 2020, and of course it is all about bloom where you're planted. So I'm super excited to be here today. My daughter and I were sitting there going, is today Tuesday or Wednesday? Tuesday or Wednesday? We're trying to remember. So anyways, I should have known better. I did a grocery run really early this morning, so, you know, just trying to remember everything. Worked a little bit outside, and it is a very hot day here in Texas. So I hope it's not as hot where you are as it is here. I know that at one point I was seeing 100, but hoping that wasn't us. So anyways, but I hope you guys are excited about today's lesson. Let's pray. Let me see. Is there any camp business? I do have camp business, but it is something that is very, very important and special. So I'm going to save it for the end. And it is something that we can do as a camp that will bless somebody very special. So hang with me till we get to the very end of the videos. Yesterday cut off at the end and I was not going to add a third video. So today we're going to stay on task. Okay, let's pray. And Dear Lord, we humble ourselves before you and we thank you for today. Jesus, we are so grateful for all that you do. Lord, please be with us in this camp. Help us to understand what it is that you're trying to teach us. And then, Lord, how we can put what you have taught us into action. And Lord, you've brought something to our attention and I'm so excited and so thankful that we can do something, that we can give back what you have given to us. Lord, let my words be only your words. Help me to get myself out of the way. And God, thank you for the opportunity to share a little testimony this week. And now we're hopefully going to start hearing new testimonies of all the different campers. Jesus, we praise you. We love you. We bow down before you. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I had talked about us covering the Lord's Prayer and how Jesus modeled how to pray. I think I'm going to scooch that to tomorrow if you guys are okay with that, because this opportunity arose last night and I'm really excited. So I really believe God was prompting and it just kind of is amazing. So I just want to tell you we're going to work on that Lord's Prayer. We're going to look at Jesus modeled to pray, but we're going to move that to tomorrow. I hope you guys are okay with that. Any other camp business? Everybody who's sending me pictures of their projects, I have not forgotten you. I have everything downloaded on my laptop. But last night I was distracted with this opportunity. And I just thank you guys so much for understanding. I'm going to get everything posted. I may reach back out and make sure that I have the right day for it. If for any reason it doesn't say day one, day two, you know, whatever. You know, day eight. Today's day eight. So, and for those of you who haven't sent me pictures yet, I would love to see what you're doing. Now, just because you send me a picture does not mean I will put it on the website. You must indicate, here is my picture for the website, and I will be glad. And then give me the name you want me to put under it, whether it be your handle on YouTube or online, or it be like mine is Josephine's Designs or Bible Journaling Camps. That's who I am. Or, you know, so if you, or if you just want to use your first name, that's perfectly fine too. So, or if you want to do first name, first letter of your last name, totally fine too. I won't do first and last name. So just for privacy. So there's that. There was one other thing I was just going to bring up. Oh, and it just escaped me. And I usually write these down, but I didn't. I just thought of it while I was talking. Hopefully it'll come to me before the camp is over. And I have my pen, I have my paper. So if I need to write it down, I will write it down. So, I am super excited. We have a really neat verse for today. So, let me know. Oh, I know what I wanted to tell you. This is why I didn't write it down. How could I forget? I got a call. This is another reason last night kind of got switched in the schedule. So I got a call, and I think you guys have kind of figured out, a lot of you have figured out, that it is my aunt who is sick. And I got a call from my cousin last night, and she was calling about something completely unrelated, and which doesn't always happen, but I love that she called. And she had good news. So my aunt was 92, turned 93 while she was battling pneumonia and COVID. Amazing. She's back in her nursing facility, which my cousins can't go see her unless it's like critical. And of course they went and saw her last week, but week before. Anyways, long story short, she's sitting up. She's eaten half her meals on a plate, which is amazing. She's lost a lot of weight, But she's, and not that she had a lot to lose. She's a little gal. And, but she ate half her food and she got up to go into the ladies' room, which, if any of you know, when you've been that sick, and especially at 93 years old, you could just choose not to. And it would be understandable at this point. And, you know, I told my cousin, I said, I'm telling you what, she and my dad, they had quite the will to live, you know. So it's just amazing to hear. My husband was outside. He was watering or doing something. And he was working on the car. And I called and told him, and he was like, oh my gosh, that's great news, you know. And so anyway, she's so cute. She calls my husband her boyfriend. And then she calls one of her grandchildren's husband her boyfriend. So she's so cute. I mean, yeah, she just is so sweet and so cute. And literally last time we went to see her, the first thing she said was, where's your husband? And I went in with my daughter, and she said, was thrilled to see my daughter. She was happy to see me, but it was like, where's your husband? He's my boyfriend. Why is he not here? And I was just like, yes, ma'am, he'll be here very quickly. So got such good news. I want to thank you guys who are praying. She is not out of the woods at all. And since they had a caregiver in the facility test positive for COVID, and she was exposed firsthand, just keep praying that she and the rest of everyone in that nursing facility, staff and patients, of course, our residents, that they would all stay clear. But she is, she is an amazing woman, and I told my cousin, you know, y'all are my heroes. She is, because she's taken such good care of her mom all these years. She helped me with my parents. And then, and she was so supportive. I just could never, ever, ever not just be in awe of her. And then her mom, because she was such an she is an amazing woman of God. I mean, she, up until a few years ago, was making like, I think she made, I can't remember the number of pies. I want to think it was something like crazy, like 28 pies by herself. And my parents went to visit her. We were in Atlanta, Georgia on a business trip for my husband. And my sister reached out to me because there was a post on Facebook from the other cousin. And so we immediately started calling to check on her. And my dad had shown up with my mom. He was up there on like a high school reunion, something like that. And he went to go visit her, and she wouldn't wake up. So she wouldn't wake up to open the door. So he went and got the, the manager, and they opened the door, and she went in, they went in and they couldn't wake her up. So they took her by ambulance to the hospital. You know, it wasn't that she was sick. It was that she was just tired. She had made 20 some odd pies by herself for the church. I mean, such an amazing woman of God. And she even shared scripture with me, her favorite scripture. And that was in both my parents', funeral services. Just an amazing woman. I'm in awe of them. And so, not perfect, but wonderful. They love the Lord and they serve God, and they do it in the way that they know best. And her husband was a preacher, and he died many years ago, and I was a young girl. And the older cousin, who we were talking back and forth, and it's my younger cousin that takes care of her, or, you know, looks in on her. And she was telling me of when her daddy died and how he was getting ready to turn 70 years old. And he said, I won't make it to be 70. And she said, oh, daddy, don't be silly. And sure enough, he went home to be with the Lord, I guess a day or two before his birthday. And, you know, I think that when you have that example of somebody walking that close with the Lord, you know, sometimes you know that, you know, and what an opportunity to know them and see God work in their lives. So anyways, I just wanted to share that encouragement. I wanted to say that 93 years old, took a licking, and seems to still be ticking. It's amazing. So thank you again. Thank you, everybody who prayed. All right, I think that's camp business for now. If I've forgotten anything, please text me or email me or whatever you want to do. Instant message me on Instagram. But again, all of you who are sending me pictures, they are phenomenal. And all of you that are sending me your prayer requests, come on back after this video. I'm going to probably... Today's Wednesday. I'll probably put it up Friday. I am going to do a project with additional... Here they are. I'm going to work on the covers of my prayer journal notebooks, and I wanted to take you with me. So I'm only going to use one of those, and I have some others. So anyways, I just thought it's fun to do a craft project every now and then. Even though we're in the middle of a camp, I try not to do extra, but There's a couple projects I have to get done. So, okay, friends, let's get started. All right, the scripture for today. Okay, I didn't carry on too long, did I? But anyways, it was praise. Okay, so pull out your scripture if you have a chance. Let me go ahead and put our sign to this side. And it is 1 Thessalonians 4:11. And I said I would work on the other scripture, so hang with me, okay? Because at the end, you'll understand why. Okay, so we're going to focus on this one scripture. You can pull out your Bible and journal in it. You can pull out your TN from our kit and work on it. And I'm going to work out the TN today. Or you can pull out your memory dex cards and we can work on it. So here we go. 1 Thessalonians 4:11, New American Standard. And to make it your ambition. To lead a quiet life and attend to your own business and work with your hands just as we commanded you. So, Paul was writing to the people of Thessalonica. I believe Thessalonica? Thessalonians? Yeah, I think that's right. Sorry. I know this. The minute the camera's not on, the camera gets on and my mind just goes blank sometimes. So, please forgive me. But he was writing a letter to the Thessalonians. And he was encouraging them. A lot of letters, if you haven't thought about this, like I had shared before, our Bible study leader goes into the women's prison here in our town, and she teaches K-Author Precept Bible Studies, and I asked her, I said, well, how are things going with the ladies at the prison here recently? And she said, I can't get in, but I'm able to email them. And I said, just like Paul wrote letters. So even when we're in a place, Paul was in prison. And he wrote a lot of letters in prison. And even when we're in a shackled, difficult place, we can still serve the Lord well. So hang on to that. That is going to tie in at the end. So we're back to another how. How do we serve well? How do we go about that? What does that mean? So let's talk about that. And to make it your ambition. So this should be your goal. This should be something that you want to get focused on. So like in our planners, it has like the top three priorities for the day or the top three priorities for the week or the top three priorities for the month. I mean, that's how you break down your goals and you build projects around your goals. And that's basically a lot of project planning, though there is a lot more intricacies. I don't want to take away from that. My husband's a certified project planner. I mean, I get that there's a lot more to it. But essentially, when we look at a goal, we look at making something our ambition, we need to focus on what that is. So I can sit down with a planner and I can fill out a list of 20. Here, you know, matter of fact, let me share this with you. So this is one of my running lists. Okay, hold on. There we go. So this is one of my running lists. I just do it in my email. I print it out, and then I always have it on my phone. I can pull it up in a draft and or I print it out. So I have a huge list here of things I have to do. Can I do that in one day? Well, if I was crazy, but I can't do it in one day. I really break it down in, like, you'll see three things checked, and then I'll do three more things and four more things, and I'll just add them in my planner. So as things tally up, I make a long list, and then I throw it into my planner and I break it down. And that's really what project planning is. Project planning is taking an end result, listing all the steps it takes to get there, and breaking it down in small doable increments. On that list, I have several canning projects. I have salsa, jalapeno relish, spicy pickles. Well, I couldn't do spicy pickles until I ordered the spices on Amazon. So when you think about that, you have to order what's the most important, what are the main priorities, and then break it down each day. Like if you have a week, break it down on the days of the week that you're going to attend to those things. So for me, basically Monday through Friday, I will can on Saturday sometimes, sometimes not. And depends on, you know, just what's going on that weekend. So like this weekend again, our son and daughter-in-law are going to come back by, and maybe our oldest daughter and son-in-law, they may come too on Saturday evening. If that be the case, I will not can on Saturday. I will can, you know, the next day, or I'll push it off to the next week. So as I look at this and I think about this verse, so as we go through verses, we need to take them apart. We need to read the context of the verses, what went on before, during and the verse itself and what went on afterwards. We need to understand the author. We need to understand the time frame. We need to understand where they are. Those are the things you want to break down. Then we look at the scripture itself, and it says, and to make it your ambition. So this is something that we should set up as a goal. Let's see what that goal is. To lead a quiet life. There's a lot to be said for that. I'm always amazed at having, I was a very shy person. You would not know that now, but, you know, except for that I don't have my picture everywhere. I was a very shy person when I was young, even to the point where my husband thought I was mute when he saw me in our, I was in college, he was in the military, Sunday school class. Then he finally heard me read one day, and he was just like, oh my goodness, that girl can talk. So, now my girlfriends knew that I talked, because if I knew you, I would talk a lot. And, you know, I didn't have any problems with that. I mean, I wouldn't always assert myself, but I would definitely, you know, talk to my close friends. And I could giggle and laugh and have all the good stuff. You know, it wasn't like I was painfully shy. I was shy, but not painfully shy. And then my husband and I was trying to get him interested in my roommate. I ended up, you know, kind of liking him. We ended up being really good friends. And then from there, we went on and dated. And anyways, it was just one of those things. And he was, and the reason I remember, we showed up in our Sunday school class. And we had a big, like, you know, fun time, you know, like a gathering of some sort at the church. And I remember telling my girlfriends, I'll go with anybody but that guy, because he was so talkative. And I was just like, wow, he talks a lot, you know. And the point was, once we got married, he was like, you have to stand up for yourself. You have to talk. And then later he was like, oh, maybe you talk too much, but you know, anyways, but the thing is, we have to see what that is. So what is a quiet life? If you are not painfully shy, then sometimes a quiet life is really nice. I mean, we don't live in the city. We were more in the country when we moved here. The city has moved out to us. And one of the things I told my husband recently is hear the trucks. I don't like hearing the noise anymore. I want my quiet back. You know, I said, we can hear them at night too. You know, they're a mile away, but we can still hear them. And he was like, oh, it's only when the wind blows this way. And it's only when it's this, that, and the other. And I said, honey, we can still hear them. And we're both kind of hard of hearing, you know, so, but, and he knows at some point we'll go deeper. I mean, he knows that. And when I say deeper, we'll go deeper in the bush is a term down here. We met a man years ago, and I remember asking him, you know, what are you going to do when the city grows out to you? And he goes, I'm going to go deeper. And I said, deeper? And he goes, yeah, deeper in the bush. And I said, gotcha. So I think that's our goal. You know, our son and daughter-in-law want to go in together and get land. And as we age, they want to be available. And then, you know, they're just super sweet to think like that. And it depends on what's going to happen with our youngest daughter and our oldest daughter and son-in-law. The land they were purchasing, it all fell through, and it had nothing to do with them. It had to do with the sellers, and there were issues with the seller. And nothing that they did. It just had to do with some of their, just their side, their business side of it. So we were trying to position ourselves between the two, thinking the youngest would come with us, but I don't think it's time yet. I think we have to wait and see where everybody's going to situate, you know, where everybody's going to end up, and then God's going to show us. But a quiet life is so nice. I mean, I grew up in the city, though I had all the critters living in that should have been in the country, you know, but out in the country. And I remember when I go over and visit my uncles and aunts' ranches, I loved it. I mean, I loved it. I loved everything about it. I love riding horses. I love being out in the middle of nowhere. I love seeing the wildlife. And even the things that I haven't enjoyed, like I'm highly allergic to bees. And with EpiPen being so expensive, I can't get an EpiPen. And I am dangerously allergic to Benadryl, which is what you take if you can't take an EpiPen. And so, but the interesting thing is, when we put all these gardens in, God brought into our world all of these butterflies and bees and birds and hummingbirds, of course. And the thing that's amazing is they don't want anything to do with me now because they're about their business. They're getting their work done. They're going from flower to flower. They're helping to create the garden. And, you know, their job is to go and collect the pollen and take it back to the hive. And, of course, my husband has hives way in the back of our property. And I'm literally pointing to where they are, where I'm sitting here right now. And yes, we've had dangerous situations with our bees that I could never go out and be around. But my husband seems to think that the Africanized colony has moved on, which that'll happen. Your bees will just move on to another hive. But because we are continually growing now, it's amazing what's happening. So I was telling my husband, I said, I love seeing the bees now because they don't want anything to do with me. And he was like, yeah, they're working. And I said, yes, the great thing is they're about their business, just like I'm about my business. They don't want anything to do with me. I don't want to mess with them. And today I was out there this morning tearing down two of the cucumber vines and the plants. And I was talking to a sweet Christian friend of mine on the phone while I was doing it. And she was great because she was asking me questions about gardening and things. And so, which I know not, I'm learning. And it was great because, you know, that I could see the bees and I was watching them and I was thinking, okay, you little guys, I know there's a few blossoms left. I'm going to leave them on the ground till my husband can haul them away. But I was starting to pull down the old because part of me not only wants the produce to be healthier and fresher, it's that the blossoms will be healthier and fresher for the butterflies, for the bees, for the birds, everything. So there is this quiet life that takes place in God's creation. And it's a blessing, and I love it. So let's keep going. And it says, and attend to your own business. So just like those bees, they're doing their thing, I'm doing my thing. And yes, I'm doing what I can to help them. You know, filling the water. We have bird baths all throughout the gardens because we were told that birds will eat our my husband was telling me that the birds will eat your produce if you don't have water. And he was so funny. He goes, well, that wasn't true. After we bought all these, they weren't expensive, inexpensive little bird baths, and we put them out. And he was like, well, that wasn't true. And I was like, well, it's okay. I mean, we do know we have a lot of birds. And, you know, so we had to put bird netting up or deer netting so they couldn't get at the produce. But it was still fine. It was all still fine. But there is something about when we are about our whatever the business God has for us, guess what? We don't get distracted. If we stay focused, if we keep our eyes on Him. Years ago, you know, I was talking about that college and career fellowship that we had that day at church. And it was just a fun get together, have dinner. You know, I can't remember if we played games. I don't remember what we did that night. But I had started, after my husband and I got ready, we both started teaching middle school kiddos in Sunday school, and then my husband had his work schedule change, so it was just me, and then I was asked, would I be willing to take over youth events, and then high school as well, so I brought high school in with the junior high, and I'd never seen myself as a junior high or high school teacher, and I was still pretty young, but I had grown up in youth group. And with really good youth group leaders, youth group ministers. And so God was really gracious. But one thing I noticed was if we did not have a purpose for getting together, which we later discovered Bible study is the best, of course, and it's okay to have the fun events, but people would get their feelings hurt. Something always happens. Somebody said something. Somebody did something. And somebody would get their feelings hurt. And then we noticed when we had children, if they didn't have a good list of activities, then they would waste their day away or they would get in trouble. And not that our kids got in a lot of trouble. They didn't. But I mean, just saying, though, idle hands, you know. And so when we see that and attend to your business and work with your hands, those are good things. Those are good plans. That should be what we should be planning each day. We should seek the Father, go to Him and say, hey God, it's your day. You guide my steps. Please show me what your purpose and will is for my day, for my week, for my month, for the year. So think that through. And sometimes God gives you long-range goals. Sometimes he gives you short-range goals. But we should be about our Father's business. And we should be seeking to please him and do everything as we can as if unto him. Pardon me. Sorry. So, and then he goes on to say, just as we commanded you. So it's not we mentioned it, we asked you, we commanded you. We commanded you. So thinking on this, what is it that we can do? I'm going to get a sip of tea if you don't mind. I took a vitamin and that's what's causing me to choke. Hold on one sec. Sorry. Oh, goodness. I took my vitamins and one of them got stuck and it's still giving me problems. So I apologize. So as we think about this verse and we think about the people in Thessalonica and in the Thessalonians, there was a lot of rabble rousing going on. There were some things that they were definitely getting distracted by. And Paul was about getting everybody on track. And when I was younger, I thought, well, he's just a bully. But now I see that purpose, that intent, that will, that want or wish for everybody to be about their Father's business and not get distracted and not get into trouble. You know what I mean? And I'm going to be honest. I'm 29 years old, quote unquote, and I'm not. But and just so you know, my oldest turns 30 this year, so I'm not. But I am a person that understands that if I have too much free time, nothing gets done. If I don't stack my day, like getting up today and getting to the grocery store earlier and getting all these things in motion, yes, I'm tired. Yes, I have not had great sleep all week, but I am so thankful that I got that done. I really am. I'm so thankful. So, and I think that for the Lord, I was more productive, and I was absolutely in awe because I can tire easily because of my autoimmune. But I was, you know, pulling out all the vines and talking to my girlfriend and, you know, working and clipping and, you know, harvesting produce and all of that. And I was, when I got through with it, I was like, I mean, I was very hot because it's 100. I mean, it's hot. And, you know, and it says it feels like 105. Yes, it does. It feels like 105. And to come in and change my shirt, I was just so hot and sweaty. And, but I got through and I cooled down for a while and I took care of some things online and I took care of some phone calls and all that kind of good stuff. But I was like, wow, God, I can actually talk and get things done even though I'm tired. And I realized that that was God's plan and purpose. I was following what he said to do. So I got back from the grocery store. My daughter came and got the groceries out of the car. My knee is getting, you know, it's giving me fits. So carrying things up and down the steps is really something I can't do. And right now. And so she is so sweet about that. And so she came and got the groceries. She attended to the groceries. She's finishing up in the kitchen right now. You know, we stopped in mill. She put all the cold stuff away. And then she's working on the other stuff. And I'm just so thankful because I then got a lot done in the garden. And it was just like bam, 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 bam. And I can't wait to get back on that list up there and start checking everything off. So I think God does have a plan. God is not a God of chaos. He really is a God of order, and he has a plan for things. I mean, think about how he created the world. I mean, he had a plan for each and every day. And it wasn't a long to-do list. I mean, seriously, he created the day and the night. Okay, that's two things. Okay, big things, but he's God, right? You know, so we can sit down with our priority list, seek the Father, ask him what he wants us to do, and we can be productive for him. And everything we do in Colossians 3:23, we should do it as if unto the Lord and do our best. Give it our very best try. It doesn't have to be perfect. It does not have to be perfect, but it has to have heart. And that's all that matters. And that's what I used to teach my children, my students, everyone. I would rather have somebody who did their very best than somebody who got an A because it was easy. Because the one who enjoyed the journey and did their very best, and maybe it was hard, but they learned more in that journey. And that's the blessing. Okay, friends, I'm going to cut off this video, come back with a second video, and we're going to start on our project. Okay, guys, I hope you're enjoying this. I hope you're hanging in there with me. Let's get into our Bible journaling. And yeah, okay. I'll talk to you in a minute. Love you guys. Bye-bye.